friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear.
Let me invite you this morning, if you have your Bible, to turn with me over to Matthew chapter 13. I want to give an introduction about this message. I, like many Americans, have been troubled with, I know it's not for everybody, but troubled with the outcome of the election. The election does bother me. One of the things that bothers me the most are the things that our new president is proposing. I find it ironic that this past Sunday, we celebrated Sanctity of Human Life, in which we as Christians remember the fact that since 1973, there have been over 62 million babies aborted here in America. We grieve not only their senseless killing, but we also fear God's judgment. I'm afraid that we are living within an age, and it's been something that's been coming on for decades now. A lot of people will trace it back to the 1960s when Madeline O'Hare ended up removing from the public school system prayers, that it was no longer constitutional. And I heard that, amen. Thank you, Mary. But we have become a godless society in a lot of ways, even though we may be known as a Christian nation. There is no longer a fear of God. And I will say that I can't help but believe that a lot of the troubles that we're seeing right now are nothing less than a judgment of God, because of our sinfulness. And I do put at the top of the list the heinous nature of the taking of innocent life. It is an abomination in God's sight, and it is a blight upon America. We have a new president, for those that are not aware, who has basically pledged that in the coming days, he is going to do everything within his power to undo every piece of legislation to protect the unborn. Even, from what I understand, to do away with the Hyde Amendment, which is one of the, when I think his name was Henry Hyde, proposed this back in the 1990s. It was to outlaw basically the most heinous type of abortion. And we have been trying to, not saying that all of them aren't heinous, but some are just terribly heinous. And the new president has vowed to undo that. I've been troubled by this, and I know that this is just my introductory comments. I was very troubled this past week when our new president ended up signing into law that boys and girls in our school systems can now use the same shower rooms, bathroom facilities. You didn't know that? That's what this whole transgender thing is. All that a student has to do is go to school and say, I identify as whatever gender I want. And from what I understand, there's nothing to keep them to say, I identify as a boy today and a girl tomorrow and a boy the next day and a girl the next day. Gender isn't decided at birth. gender is fluid. It is changeable based upon what a person feels like. So the president signed into law to allow this. He also, out of, I feel like, disrespect to women, said that he would end up allowing boys that decided they want to be known as girls compete against girls in athletic events. And for anybody that's followed that in recent years, there's no comparison between the two. The boys that, even in their transgendered state, are beating the girls and everything athletically, it is totally unfair. Now, let me say, I know that it's not the popular message, but I believe that God created two genders at birth, male and female. He created them. And we owe it to our Maker to affirm the decision that He made for us. And I say all this, that these are things that bother me about our country. And it's leading into the message this morning. As bothered as I am about the direction that our country seems to be going under the new president, and by the way, those are just two of the main things that I'm concerned about. I've already told you that in the days ahead, President Biden has announced that he's going to pass the Equality Act. And for those that aren't aware of what the Equality Act, it has a nice sound to it. Everybody wants equality. But equality means that any business or organization has to give equal treatment to a person, whatever gender, whatever sexual practice, whatever they want. Including, the great fear is, including churches, that we as a church would have to welcome behind this pulpit a transgendered person or a homosexual person, even though the Word of God strictly forbids it. And some people say, well, that's never going to happen because we have First Amendment freedom of religion. For those that weren't aware, this past summer there was a devastating piece of legislation that reached the Supreme Court. I've told you this before in case you've forgotten. There was a Christian funeral home director up in Michigan, a Christian funeral home director, that a man in his employment decided, even though he was hired as a man, for some reason decided to transition over to a woman and came to work dressed as a woman. At which point the Christian funeral home director said to the man, you know what? We can't have this going on at our Christian funeral home because this does not represent the values that we hold. The Christian funeral home director was taken to court. The case was taken all the way to Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court ruled in favor of the transgendered man and fined the Christian funeral home director $90,000. That wasn't the worst part of it. Because the Supreme Court, in their infinite wisdom, went back to a piece of legislation that goes back to the days of Martin Luther King Jr., the 1964 Civil Rights Act, an act that was passed back in the mid-1960s that basically said here within our country that you could not discriminate against a person because of their gender, their age, their race. And they decided as a Supreme Court that the things listed that you could not discriminate against was not sufficient to cover everything in our modern day, that we needed to update it. So they added to the 1964 Civil Rights Act that you can no longer discriminate against a person if they're homosexual or if they decide to be transgender, bisexual, so on and so forth. There were a couple, if I understand correctly, a couple of our Supreme Court justices, Justice Alito and Justice Thomas, that ended up saying, look, the original writers of this back in 1964 had no intention that people that practice transgender be protected. That was the furthest thing from their mind. Back in 1964, this was considered deviant behavior. That's the way it was considered back then. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, up until the 1990s, it was considered a person had a mental problem. But now all of that has to change. And Justice Thomas and Justice Alito said, look, they did not intend for the law to be changed to include that. And the other justices overruled them, and they changed the definition of the 1964 Civil Rights Act. And both Justice Thomas and Justice Alito, they ended up saying, do you realize by changing this and now making it wrong for you to discriminate against a person based upon the homosexual or transgender, that you are going to put at risk the churches with their religious belief? And they basically said, if it has to put them at risk, so be it. In fact, our incoming president said on the campaign trail back in the fall that churches are going to have to take a back seat to the new law. In other words, you're not going to be allowed to object based on your freedom of religion. And having said that, folks, I've been distressed. You folks know the level of my distress. We hold within America our freedom of religion of utmost importance. That's why it's called a First Amendment right. When the founders of our country sat down and they decided to make a list of the things they wanted protected, they said, we want to, above all else, make sure that we protect our freedom of religion, because they came over here from overseas and they knew what it was to be persecuted because of their religion. We want to protect our religion, and we also want to protect our freedom of speech. And folks, for those of you that haven't noticed what's been going on in the past 2 weeks, you need to get your head out from under the sand. Freedom of speech is being censored left and right. As upset as I am about all of this stuff within America, there's even something even more that I am upset about. And it comes from this passage of Scripture. Because some of y'all sitting there, why'd you always turn to Matthew chapter 13? The thing that upsets me even more than what's going on within America right now is what's going on within the church. I know that there are those who end up saying, you just let that political stuff deal with the people outside, deal with that stuff, deal with the stuff within the church. And that's what I intend to do this morning. But when I preach this message, it is with regard to the condition of the church today. Because if you haven't figured it out by now, the church today isn't what the church used to be in days gone by. You would have thought with the two issues being so clearly delineated between the candidates that we had for our presidential election, that it would have been a slam dunk, that the church would have ended up saying, we look at these two issues, if nothing else, and hands down, we vote for the candidate that is going to be against abortion, and we vote for the candidate that is going to stand up for our religious rights. But my heart has been broken. Because the numbers that I get from today's church is that rather than the church standing up for right and godliness, the church, not all of the church, but a good portion of the church, has become totally corrupt. And my heart is broken. I am not only broken on the inside, that the church has fallen from its position of influence, and Jesus said it very simply to Christians back in his day. Hey, folks, look, you are to be a light. You are to shine as a light in the communities in which you live about the things that matter to God. He also said that the church of today was to be salt. And he said that if the church has lost its saltiness, it is good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled under the feet of men. You say, how corrupt has the church become? I suppose that nothing would paint the picture any better than the Senate race that took place down in Georgia here within the past couple weeks. In fact, one of the candidates down there that ended up winning labeled himself as reverend. He needs to put an I in front of reverend so that you have irreverend. Amen. Claiming to be a minister of the Word of God at the very church that Martin Luther King Jr. pastored. And yet he is very much pro-abortion and states it outwardly. I bring this up, folks, to call your attention to what I'm seeing as a pastor. I am both heartbroken at the condition of the church and I am also outraged. I talked with a brother of the Lord this past week and I ended up saying to him, I feel like as a pastor walking away from the church. If the church doesn't stand for righteousness, what in the world does it stand for? I say baloney to those that would end up saying, just preach Jesus, that Jesus saves everybody and he saves them to do whatever they want to. And I say, you are preaching a false gospel. Jesus started by saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. You say, well, you've sat through 10 to 15 minutes of warm-up. What's your text? I've been reminded, as I've thought about this, Jesus saw this coming a long time ago, and he gave us in Matthew chapter 13, beginning with the 24th verse, a parable. This is what he said in Matthew chapter 13, verse 24. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. Is there anything wrong with the seed that God sows? Absolutely not. I want to remind you, again, I know that I brought up these two issues and maybe you say, don't bring these issues up again. I want to remind you, God labels stuff as bad. And I don't care if you're talking... I don't care if you're talking abortion or the homosexuality or the transgender. I don't care if you're talking that or if you want to go down the road of alcohol or drugs or pornography or you name it. God labels that stuff as bad because it hurts you. God doesn't just indiscriminately say, I'm going to call something sin just to make a list of things that are bad. He labels it because he knows that it's going to cause problems. With regard to the abortion issue, do you know how many millions of women in America, even though they had an abortion years ago, when the date of the birth of their child comes around, the child that was aborted, they go through a period of mourning. Have you ever talked with one of these women? I have. Even though nobody else ever knew about it, they didn't make it public knowledge. They know that down in their heart, because nobody else is there pointing an accusing finger, they know down in the depths of their heart that what they did was wrong. And it eats at their soul year in and year out. And there's not one thing that I as a minister can do for them to undo what they did. Do you know how many people that are rushing to embrace the transgender thing gonna find out that even though they go through the transition physically to become the opposite gender, they are not going to find the acceptance that they're wanting. They're not going to find the acceptance that they're wanting from other people, and more importantly, they're not going to find the acceptance that they want from themselves. They will know that they're living a lie. God in His wisdom, when it talks about a seed that is sown, folks, in the kingdom of heaven, God has given us a book that ends up telling us, look, if you follow this, if you try not to argue, if you try to avoid what Satan did back in the garden, where Satan began to question God, did God really say? And you begin to call into question that you know better than God. You're going to find that God is infinitely wiser than you've ever been or ever will be. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field, and the word of God is good seed. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came, sowed weeds among the wheat, went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from? An enemy did this, he replied. The servants asked him, do you want us to go and pull them up? No, he answered, because while you're pulling the weeds, you may root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds, tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn. The passage of Scripture is, I feel like, talking about the church. Some might care to disagree. But when I read this passage of Scripture, it speaks to my heart about the condition of the church today. How in the world did the church... Let me just ask you, these questions that I've just raised, you know, about the transgender homosexual thing, would that have been accepted 40 years ago in the church? Why wasn't it accepted? Why? Because as you go through history, this isn't the first time that we've had to address this issue. You are aware that this issue was around back in the Old Testament. This is nothing new. Solomon ended up saying in the book of Ecclesiastes, hey folks, there's nothing new under the sun. What goes around?
Comes around.
You don't think it's something new. You know why it was rejected in the past? Because it doesn't work. It's a blight. It's harmful. But somehow, during the course of the past few decades, the field of the Lord has become choked with weeds. I want to deal with five things here right quick. I'm not going to keep you past the time. Reading Warren Wiersbe's commentary, it's the one commentary that I read a lot. He warned about five things that I want to share as kind of a warning sign to each one of us, that you and I might kind of watch out for these things. That we don't get, I know some people say, you and I can't become weeds. Well, yeah, I believe that once saved, always saved. If you've received the Holy Spirit in your life, you're always going to be offended by this stuff. But I tell you what, I don't want to see any more people that I thought were wheat become weeds. People say, do you really feel like that some of the people you thought were wheat have become weeds? I don't know how else to explain it. Because I tell you what, they are not the person that I knew at one time. They are accepting things that are contrary to the Word of God, and they're unashamed of it. And I want to grab them by the shoulders and shake them really hard and say, why don't you come to your senses? Our God has not changed, and His standards haven't either. The five things that I want to call your attention to. First of all, there are such things as counterfeit Christians. There's a passage of Scripture. Look with me over in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Try to go through these rather quickly. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, for those of you who know, 2 Corinthians chapter 11 is where the Apostle Paul talks about all of the stuff that he went through. You know how he was beaten with a whip five times, beaten with rods three times, he got stoned, so on and so forth. But if you go down to the 26th verse of that 11th chapter, he says, I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea. And the last one, and in danger from false brothers. And I preach this as a message to the church this morning to say, hey folks, guard yourself from those who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ and are not. Amen, Pastor. I thought that Jesus said you and I shouldn't judge lest we be judged. I tell you, don't misapply that passage of Scripture. You and I make judgment calls all the time. And Jesus is the one that ended up saying, you will know them by their fruit. What is it that they are trying to produce? Is it godliness and righteousness? Or is it pain and heartache? Let me ask you a question. In the next few days, when President Biden signs all the legislation to re-equip the whole pro-abortion thing, and there is unfettered, not just access to all the abortion stuff that you want, but there's taxpayer funding of it. When he signs that piece of legislation, and you realize that behind the stroke of that pen, there are literally going to be millions of more babies that are killed. Some of them in the most, I'm not even going to describe what they do in the killing of some of these babies. I want you to transport yourself from that location where the president has that ink pen and signing into law this piece of legislation. Transport yourself from there to the portals of heaven. And let me ask you, do you think that up in heaven that the angels are going to go, whoopee, kill them all? Absolutely not. Heaven weeps. Heaven weeps. Because every single one of those babies were made in the image of God. Guard yourself from counterfeit Christians. Guard yourself, the second thing, guard yourself from a counterfeit gospel. Galatians chapter 1. Through 9, the Apostle Paul writes to the Christians there in the region of Galatia. He says, I am absolutely astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. As we've already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let him be eternally condemned. I know some people say, well, go ahead and read the rest of it, because what the Apostle Paul is talking about, these Galatians that were wanting to embrace their Jewish history and their Jewish traditions, in which they felt like that they could be saved by works rather than by grace. Look at the end of the book. Galatians chapter 5, beginning in the 19th verse. The gospel of Jesus Christ is about the grace of Jesus Christ, but it is also about turning away from wickedness. In the 19th verse of chapter 5, he says, the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. The last part of that verse says this, and pay careful attention. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't ever try to pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ into believing that you are just saved by grace and you can live any way that you want to, because grace covers it all. That, my friends, is a perverted and distorted interpretation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Be careful of counterfeit Christians. Be careful of counterfeit gospel. Be careful of counterfeit righteousness. From Romans chapter 10, verses 1 through 3. Brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. And I will say it's not just for Israelites, I pray for everybody. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge, since they did not know the righteousness that comes from God and sought to establish their own. They did not submit to God's righteousness. You and I need to guard ourselves not only from counterfeit Christians, from a counterfeit gospel, but from a counterfeit righteousness that denies the righteousness as laid out in the Word of God. Fourth item, guard yourself from a counterfeit church. Over in Revelation chapter 2, it's a message to the church at Smyrna. Revelation chapter 2. Some might say, well, this could be part of the Christians, and it could also be, you know, what I've already said about Christians and about righteousness. But from Revelation chapter 2, right into the church at Smyrna, John writes, he says this, "I know you people there, you people at Smyrna, I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but what? Are a synagogue of Satan." There are churches out there, folks, and I'm not going to get into trying to identify the ones. I get amazed at times. People come to me and tell me about ministries that they watch on television. Let me just say this to you in case you hadn't figured it out. Just because somebody says that they've got a church and they've got a religious program on television or the radio, don't think that that is pleasing in the eyes of God. I know that one that takes an awful lot of bashing on people, if you want to watch it, fine. Beware of the churches that just end up patting you on the back and telling you all the time that everything is good between you and God. If everything is so good between us and God, why is the world so bad? You know, when I go back and I read my Bible, I'm reminded that a true servant of God suffers. John the Baptist had his head cut off. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, ended up dying for his faith. Isaiah was cut in half. I mean, you could go through it. The Apostle Peter ends up being crucified upside down. Paul dies as a martyr there in Rome. You go down the list. When you find a ministry that all that they want to do is stand around and tell you what a good boy you are, you better remember Jesus' words. Beware of counterfeit churches. There are some that say they are good, and they are not. They are, as he said in the message to Smyrna, they are the synagogue of Satan. The last thing that you and I have to guard against is a counterfeit Christ. Back in April of this year, I did a number of messages from this passage of Scripture. It's the last passage of Scripture I share with you this morning, from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It has to do with the man of lawlessness. Does anybody else around here scratch their head these days about the things that are being said it's okay and the things that are being said it's wrong, it's against the law? For instance, some states, you can go and break into cars. You can rob. You can steal. You can beat people up. You go down to the precinct and they maybe do some paperwork and they turn you back out on the street. But in other states, you go to church. You go to church, you get arrested and thrown into jail. You sing songs in the church, you get arrested and sent to jail. The Apostle Paul said this, folks, you need to be aware that there's a counterfeit Christ that is coming. I'm going to read these passages of Scripture. It's a rather lengthy passage, but he says, "Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to Him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report, or letter supposed to come from us saying the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed." The man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God and is worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you these things, and now you know what is holding him back, so that he may be revealed at the proper time. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. And then, here's the Antichrist, the counterfeit Christ. Then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all signs, all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. These are troubling days. And I know that I've preached a rather lengthy message this morning. Maybe you came to church this morning saying, well, those are your concerns. I tell you what, they're not just my concerns, they're my concern for this church. Because I will tell you that there is an effort out there underway by Satan himself to destroy the good that God is doing. I read for you this morning the parable of the weeds because I feel like it's a picture of what's going on within the church today. And I want to say to those that are the wheat, you and I need to be aware in these days of the efforts that are out there to change us. There are counterfeit Christians. There is a counterfeit gospel. There is counterfeit righteousness. There are counterfeit churches. And there is a counterfeit Christ. And I don't want you to fall prey to anything that is counterfeit. We serve Jesus Christ. Shall we pray? Father, I've preached a message this morning that's been building up in me for some time. I don't know how it was received. I don't know if people will end up holding against me because I show, maybe, I hope, pray, righteous anger. Father, I preach it out of concern because these are, as my dad oftentimes quotes from 2 Timothy chapter 3 or 4, these are perilous days. These are days, Father, that we can't afford to allow our guard to be let down. These are days that we need to rely more heavily than ever upon what your unchanging word has taught us. And if it leads to persecution, then Father, grant us the courage and the strength to stand up in the midst of it and say, the God that I serve is right, and I refuse to change. I pray, Father, that you might use the message this morning to help examine our hearts and lives and make sure that we are not being corrupted by the influence of those who would want to destroy the good that your Spirit wants to do in our lives. Open our eyes, Father, to the danger around us, and grant us, Father, the strength and courage to stand strong for what is right. I ask, Father, during this time of invitation, if there are decisions that we need to make, help us to make them now, that we might honor you, your Son, Jesus Christ, and your Holy Spirit who dwells within our hearts. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Please turn to page 478 and please stand.
Sunday night, we will end up having a music night. Are our hearts and minds clear? Let's be dismissed in this morning with a closing word of prayer. Donnie, it's good to have you here, along with Adam. Glad that Adam came. Would you lead us a closing prayer? I appreciate it.
Thank you, Father, for a first Sunday morning. Thank you for all of us that are here, come to worship. Thank you, God, for letting us all be wheat and not weeds. Now as we go to our homes, bless us and keep us. Thank you for all our blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.